And so I pray, God, that we would shake off all that holds us and hinders us from hearing your voice, that you would take off the blinders and that you would remove every hindrance, every hard heart would be softened so that we can hear you and enter into your presence now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Get on our feet, amen, and let's open up our hearts and give to him all that he deserves, our love, our gratitude, amen, all of our thankfulness. He has sustained us. He has done great things through the conference. Hallelujah. And those of you that have not been able to be a part today, you're going to get a big portion, amen. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. Can we put our hands together for the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Hallelujah.
Is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless and all in wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Go back to verse 1 again. Do that again.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the old earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless? This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes me orphan, a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you you've done for me.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All that you've done.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
That's right.
Worthy is the King who conquered the
Let's do that again. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered.
One more time.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
There's been many, many miracles. The fact that we have accepted the Lord as our Savior, the fact that He took our place, that's a big miracle, amen? But not only that, He's done a lot of things with a lot of us. So I want to challenge you today to exit out of your comfort zone a little bit and come and join us here to the front. Do not let us worship the Lord alone here. Just come as you are. Amen. And let the Lord fill you up. Hallelujah. Fill your heart. Fill your soul. Fill it with hope. Fill it with wisdom. Amen. So we can take it to the streets. We can take it to the schools. We can take it to our workplace. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus. All right. And I'm just going to teach you a little step here. I take you at your word. You said it, I believe it. I seen how good it works. If you start it, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. Hallelujah, you know it. So let's worship the Lord with all our hearts. Come on, there's more of you that are in the back that belong here in the front. Do not be embarrassed. Nobody's gonna look at you. Amen. Hallelujah. Spoken over you. And if that is you, just close your eyes while we just sing this part a cappella. You say your love will never give up. You say your grace is always enough. You said your heart will never forsake or forsake me. You said I'm safe. You call me yours. You said my future's filled with your hope. You never fail, so I know that you never fail me. Let's sing that again over your life, over your family. You say your love will never give up. You say your grace is always enough. You say your heart will never forsake or forsake. He's not gonna forsake you. You say I'm safe. You call me yours. You said my future's filled. He said about you, he will do it. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. We thank you. We thank you. Don't go back to your seat. Amen. Keep on praising him. If you want to get on your knees, welcome to. If you want to get on the floor, welcome. Welcome, welcome. There's freedom in the house. If you want to be in the alleys, amen. Get on your knees right there where you are at. Lift your hands or close your eyes. However the Spirit leads you, just don't ignore Him. And let your heart be filled with Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. I sing praises to your name. Praises to your name. The name that's so much higher than all names. Higher than sickness. as you do, think about everything that has been oppressing you. That name is above all of that. Hallelujah. Sí, Señor, you're so good, so good. Be lifted higher. Than any doubt. You are higher than any fear. Estás más alto que todo rechazo. Estás más alto que toda amargura. Por eso te levantamos. We'll lift you up. We'll lift you up. Linger in there. Behold him. Don't rush out. Thank you, God. Thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name ascends above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and possessions. Your name ascends above them all, and the angels cry, oh, Son forever to the Lamb. Come on, sing it out. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We will sing the song. To the Lamb of God. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, praise you, praise you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Behold them, behold them. Spirit, that there is people today that are going with double measure of faith. You came in with a portion, God is giving you a double portion of faith. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. It's hard to come up here after singing so much. I don't know how you guys do it. And Pastor Leonard needs to worship and then get up and preach. My voice can't handle that so well. Thank you all for joining us for that beautiful worship service. Thank you for each and every one of you here. I am Lily Blair, and I am the nursery and preschool coordinator on the other side of this hallway here. And we are so grateful for each and every one of you here and each and every one of you that have joined us live on Facebook, online, or will watch this later on our YouTube channel, Covenant of Grace Fellowship. Thank you again that each of one of you are here, and we want to take a minute to mingle and welcome both new and old faces. There's a lot of new faces today for our special weekend that we've had. So why don't we all take a minute and say hi to the people around us and give them a hug and welcome them. All right, everybody. I hope you were blessed getting to see all those people that care so deeply that you are here today. So go ahead and take your seats, and we'll continue with our announcements. We had a wonderful weekend here with Christian International Prophetic Conference. It was a huge blessing, not just the weekend, it was the tail end of the week too. Thank you so much to all the volunteers who made that happen, who helped clean the church and run everything and make sure it happened smoothly. And those who served during the conference, thank you so very much. We are so thankful that we had such a wonderful weekend. And with that, we will have our video announcements.
I'm Doug Wright. This is my wife, Vicky. She has pink hair, if you didn't notice. She's not real tall. It makes it easy to pick her out in a crowd, like, you know, at the basketball game or something like that. We've been in the church for many years and involved in a lot of things. I'm an elder and do prayer ministry, and I work in the accounting office. And
I worked in the food bank for a lot of years, and now I am heading up the gift shop area and also involved in worship ministry.
And we are delighted to bring you March announcements. Our first announcement is Friday, March 15th. We're having prayer and worship warfare. Beto will be leading us that time. We're real excited about that.
And that will be at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary again on Friday, March 15th.
And don't forget, every other Friday. We have our prayer meeting out in the
coffee room.
Coffee room. That's right. So be there. Friday, March 22nd, Colorado Christian University Symphony and Jazz Band is coming to Covenant of Grace.
This is a 50-person band, which, Wayne, you now know they're coming at 6 p.m. at Covenant of Grace.
There will be a love offering, and Wayne, you've got to figure out where to put them. Sunday, March 31st is Easter. It's early this year. Don't miss it. Be there. We're going to have the services at a local park. Susanna, our office coordinator and Mary's right-hand person, is getting that all set up for us.
We will have community outreach, and we need volunteers for the booths and evangelistic teams that will be involved. Also, we will have for the kids face painting and games.
So please be there. It's a good time to worship the Lord and to rejoice in the fact that He died for us and rose again. Okay, so we've been asked to make a special announcement, and that special announcement is this. The media and presentation team needs additional recruits. We've got some great people to teach you how to do the pro presenter, to work with the sound, to work with video recording like we're doing now, and things like that.
Pro presenter is putting the words up on the screen. The sound is the sound, and it's not hard. I do it. So anybody can be taught.
And we need a deep bench. You know what that means? That means when the main team is pooped, you can come in and handle it. Thanks. Is putting that all together for us?
We will have volunteers. Sorry.
Take two. Take three.
He just hit me.
Well,
you didn't say anything.
I know I didn't. Yeah. I didn't. You're right.
We have it on video.
They are such a blessing, and we are so thankful for them. Great job, guys. So, a couple other things. So CCU, Christian Colorado University, is coming. If you remember, I think my second oldest was a baby the last time they came, and he is 16, almost 17. So they came before, you might remember, and it was an absolute blessing. We had a couple of the girls stay at our house overnight, and I am still so blessed by those 15 hours they stayed with us. Absolutely wonderful, wonderful people. So we're going to have the Fenders come up just super, super fast and tell us more about that, maybe? Yes, Miss Peggy is coming in, Mr. Fender.
Thank you, Lily. For those of you who don't know me, Peggy Fender, my husband Terry. My daughter Kirsten Turner is a graduate from CCU, and we're going to show a quick video that she put together so you have an idea of who's coming. We have it, guys.
Hey, Covenant of Grace family, it's Kirsten Turner, and I have an exciting announcement to share with you. The Colorado Christian University Wind Ensemble and Jazz Band is going on tour this spring through Arizona, and they will be playing at Covenant of Grace. This band is incredibly special to me, as I was a part of it through my 4 years in college. 11 years ago, we played at Covenant of Grace while on tour, and to this day, it is still talked about as being one of the best and most fun concerts in the history of the band. Mark your calendars for the evening of Sunday, March 24th, to hear the next generation of amazing musicians. These students love the Lord and are using their talent all for His glory. And who knows, there may be a special alumni appearance as well. It's going to be a night to remember.
last week, Luis wasn't sure how we would get, it's about 43 people up here, but as you can see from the video, they fit. And thank you again, Lillian. She was very blessed. People still talk about it. So we're up here just to recruit. If you could please open your heart, we need homestays for these wonderful students. This is our next generation of young people who are going to be serving the Lord. And so Kirsten was a part of that. And those of you who know her know she is married with two children and serving the Lord. And so this school is just a wonderful, wonderful Christian school. And the band itself, the unity that they have, they learn community. And so I'm just asking you to be able to pray about this and think about being able to take in a couple students, both male and females, but we separate them. So we have several people that have already committed to doing the homestay. So what we ask, I will be out in the foyer at the end of service. I will have a sign-up sheet if you're able to sign up today. We will be doing a dinner for them on Sunday before they actually play. And then this would be the home base. You would take them home on Sunday, come back here Monday morning. We're actually going to have a breakfast for them on Monday. And then they're going to be going to play at Scottsdale Christian School around Thunderbird and Tatum. And they have asked if perhaps we could take them in for two nights. If you can do that, that would be such a blessing. And then we would just ask that you would have a light breakfast for them on Tuesday morning. And again, this would be the base where everybody would come back. So again, thank you for your time, and please pray. They're really a blessing, and I think that you would be blessed if you would take this opportunity to meet them. Thank you.
There's one thing I think they said Friday up here. It's actually Sunday night. Sunday night at 6 o'clock. So Sunday the 24th. I just wanted to say that I remember being in the audience and looking around at the Covenant of Grace family and the enthusiasm, just how much the people here enjoyed that concert. And I wasn't surprised to hear that this is like one of the best concerts they ever give. This is one of the best audiences they ever performed before. So And talking to, like Lily said afterwards, I just talked to various people that hosted the students and just how much they enjoyed having them. And so you will enjoy. If you come, I won't guarantee. Well, I'm very sure that you will enjoy this if you come on Sunday night. And that, so like Peggy says, so please pray and consider hosting a couple students.
Thank you. And one more quick announcement. Yarcia wanted me to let everyone know that there is a meeting for the African congregation for anyone who can attend next Sunday, March 10th. I'm assuming that's right after service. Yes, okay, right after service. So that's for our African congregation. So now we will take offering. We will honor God with our giving and allow him to use our sacrifice. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for all that you've blessed each and every person with. And I thank you that we can choose to walk in obedience to you by giving to all the things that you have, and that we show our obedience and we show our growth and we show our love for you by walking in that obedience. And I pray, God, that you would help each person to give with a cheerful heart, knowing that each and every penny is in your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So if you want to give online, or you can bring your offering here to this box.
Hey, good morning. So we've been talking about tithing. Pastor Emilio and Mary asked if I'd come up and relay some of the things that I feel about tithing. First of all, I'm a firm believer and have been doing so for years. Tithing is a very high priority. Giving to the Lord in all our ways, whether it's our time, whether it's our finances, is really, really important. And I believe he blesses those that do that. And here's where the story begins. I'm going to try to make this quick, because I know Brother Gale wants to get up here and preach to us. Right, brother? Amen. So within the last year, I had somebody approach me here at church and say, hey, you know, I'm interested in hearing about what you've done over the years for finances, which I took as a great compliment. And as I began to answer some of his questions and talk back and forth with this person, I soon was reminded, I realized it, but I didn't realize it as much until that came up, of how much the things that I was talking about, I had to say, well, you know, I didn't really do that. That was a real coincidence that God put in my life. And here's one example. Going back about 12 years, it was in 2012, we just came out of the economy where the housing market dropped, and one of the things that I felt led to do was to try to purchase a short sale. And I had a realtor who I still use, known her for many, many years, and we put in offer after offer after offer. And because mine was not cash, even though I was on a couple of these homes, the highest bidder, I didn't get the house. So the realtor said, hey, you know, Roy, this takes time putting in these offers, and you're just not going to get it. I said, you know, I understand. So I kind of, you know, put that on the back burner. Didn't worry about it, didn't really do much. It was about 8 months later, I get a call from my realtor out of the clear blue sky, and she said, I got a house for you. And what the situation was, it was a person in her realty group, I guess you'd say, and she was going to be able to kind of control what would happen on both sides. She said, we can do it for financing. So we went through that process and put an offer in. And man, I don't know if you guys ever do a short sale. I've only done one. A year later, she calls again. She said, hey, they're ready to close on it. They're ready to do this. I said, okay. So we got our financing, and the guy who was doing the financing really messed up. He was out of town. We're down to 2 days before closing, and I don't have the money set up to go for this home. My realtor says, we got to get this done because houses have started to go back up. And she said, you know, they might still sell it to you, but they could very likely say, well, now the price has gone from $50,000 up to $80,000. So I was kind of freaking out a little bit, to be honest with you. I put together some ideas and actually, through the generosity of a few people, came up with cash to do this deal. So we got the money down there, and my realtor says, man, I don't know if this is going to close. She said, the title company, just, it doesn't look good. She said, but get the money down there, and at least they have that part. So I'm not sure what her reasoning was on that. But at any rate, I drove it down there early in the morning, and I called her from my motorcycle, not while I was driving, of course. But I said, hey, do you want to, you know, go grab maybe a cup of coffee or something? And she said, well, did you get the email? I said, well, I'm sitting on my motorcycle at the title company. I just dropped the money off. And she said, well, the house went through. I said, really? So I was very surprised. I got home and looked at the email. I'd never met this person, never talked to this person from the title company, emailed me, and the very first opening line in that email was, wait for it, it was, miracles still happen. Amen. And one little tidbit of information, that was 2012. I still own the house. There's a program that comes out. The person who does a lot of the financing on the homes I've done, refinances and stuff, sends this out automatically, and it goes through your home and tells you about it, what the value is. Last month, I looked, and it tells you the percentage that house has increased since when you bought it. Over 600% increase. That is God, my friends. That is God. So I've learned a couple things over the years that I believe are scriptural. First of all, give God thanks for everything, even if you don't have much. You gotta be thankful. He wants to know that you love him because you love him, not because of what you have. Second thing is spend time with him. He will guide and direct your ways and meet your needs, and in this case, much more. Praise God. Thank you.
Let's welcome Pastor Emilio.
Thank you. What a blessing has been all week, and what a testimony. Amen. Isn't that amazing what God does? God is still doing miracles. How many believe God is still making miracles right now, doing miracles? Amen. Amen. I believe today he's going to be doing some miracles. Amen. Oh, man, that was a few amens. How about an amen? There we go. We got to believe what God says in his word. Amen. So we have a very special guest and that's been with us for the week. And it's amazing testimony. We're going to have I'm going to have Apostle Leonard introduce him. Yes, because he knows more details than he's a good friend. But I know Apostle Leonard has some greater words than me to say about him. Amen.
Thanks for the warning, Emilio. Yes, we were blessed to get to know Apostle Gale Sheehan quite a number of years ago when we kind of reconnected with Christian International and in Santa Rosa Beach, Florida. And it's probably 5 or 6 years ago now, we had our very first impact tour. Back then they were called city tours. And that's where we really got a chance to get to know this man of God. And then, of course, all the times we've gone back to the International Gathering of Apostles and Prophets. And this man, Apostle Gale Sheehan, is the head of the Christian International Apostolic Network. He works very closely with Bishop Bill Hammond, the head of Christian International, and Apostles Tom and Jane Hammond as well. And he's mightily being used by God as a voice for the apostolic and the prophetic around the nation. And he brings a powerful word of the Lord. So let's welcome Apostle Gale Sheehan to come and minister the word today. Amen.
All right, can we give one more shout to Jesus this morning? Hallelujah. Well, it is so good to be with you this Sunday morning. We have had a great week of an impact tour here, hosted by this great house. We so appreciate Apostles Leonard and Sharon and Pastor Emilio and Mary for hosting us this week. And we believe that there's been a deposit put in the house that you're going to see come to fruition in a lot of ways. You know, it's exciting to be in times of transition. Right? Sometimes we have elective transition, and sometimes we're thrust into transition when we don't even necessarily want to be in transition. But it's exciting for this house. There's kind of a parallel what's happening here and what's happening actually with Bishop Hammond as well with Christian International. He'll be 90 years old in July of this year. And so we're planning a big celebration for him at our International Gathering of Apostles and Prophets that happens in October. So we'd love to have all of you come and be a part of that. But what's happening with CI right now is that Bishop is transitioning into another season of his life and ministry, and he has set in place a transition team that's beginning to take the leadership of CI, and that is his son, Apostle Tom, Dr. Tim, and Sherilyn, three children that have been set in as a, it has a unique legal name. It's called the Bishopric Team. And so they've been set in already in this transition. And so Bishop says, yeah, he said it takes at least three people to do what I've been doing, all right? And so he said, and now I'm just going to watch over them to see if they're doing it right, all right? That's what his goal is. But he's really actually doing so many things online, Zoom to the nations and many conferences and things like that right from where he is in Florida. He actually fell earlier this year and broke his kneecap, and so it kind of curtailed his travel for this past year. And so he began to do everything at home. He had to have his legs straight for a season to heal. And someone went out and got him one of those little scooters that he could ride around on. All right. And if you know Bishop, he always wants to be first in whatever's happening, all right? He wants to be the first one on the plane if he's flying, all right? And so there were quite a few hit and runs on the scooter, all right, as Bishop bumped people and scooted them out of the way as he was headed into the places he was going. But he's doing really well. His knee's healing really good. So he's very active, and we so appreciate him and his leadership of CI. And we also really believe that there's an inheritance for you in this city, all right? Because of the apostolic and prophetic seeds that were planted many, many years ago. Bishop was here for several years. I think Apostle Tom went to high school here and graduated. And so they had a lengthy time in the city of Phoenix and planted a lot of apostolic prophetic vision for people to really follow after and to run after. And so you are some of those, I really believe, that have been set in place for this city to see that happen. Now, here, I know there's transition times that have happened over this last year or two, and is still going on, all right? Many times, transition isn't just instant, all right? It takes some time to fully move into that transition season and view. It's kind of like if you're on a battleship, you can't turn it really quick, or you throw people overboard, all right? And so I really sense that's what's happening here with Apostles Leonard and Sharon. They're moving into a new season of their apostolic calling, and they have released to Pastors Emilio and Mary the oversight of Grace Covenant in this season. And what the Lord really began to speak to me was that it's going to really represent a double portion blessing in the house. Double portions are great. Elisha asked God for a double portion of Elijah's spirit, which seemed to be a hard thing at the time. But when Elisha did see Elijah go up, he got that mantle of the double portion and actually did many more miracles than Elijah ever did, right? And so Hannah was another example that it talks about a double portion. And so I see for the house here that there is a double portion anointing for this season for you to step into, all right? And it's going to be, part of that is going to be really activating people in the marketplace. Your leaders come with a great history in business and marketplace. And Bishop Hammond has said for many years, he thinks the last major move of God that will happen outside the walls of the church in the marketplace. And so we have to be ready for what that looks like, what that means. It's going to be the church looking different than it ever has before. And so I believe that you're really positioned for that to happen. And then the thing that I saw during worship today was I saw like a watering can, like a sprinkler, all right? And there was like water that was being sprinkled on the vision of the house. It wasn't like torrential downpours, and it wasn't like a sprinkler system. It was actually the hand of God that was beginning to pour out of the things that he has for this season. And so that means some new things are going to be happening, all right? It's great to see multi-ethnic, multicultural, multi-generational church that you have. That's a tremendous blessing. And a lot of times we talk about the Joshua generation, and many times when we think of the Joshua generation, we may think of millennials or Gen Z or those that are going to be the newcomers to really occupy and possess. And I definitely believe that that's true, that that's going to happen in the house. But the good news for those that may be over 20 or 30 or 40 or 50, all right, is that when Joshua actually went in to take the land, he was between 70 and 80 years old, all right? between 70 and 80. And so for your seasoned individuals that are in the house, don't think that your day is past, all right, or that your hour is past, because God needs you at this season of time in the same way that he needs the young generations arising. So I'm very excited about what's happening for you all right now. And I think during this year of 24, you're going to see some of the things that God has had planned for a long time begin to be unveiled, and you're going to be able to step into that, into that season. I want to share something with you today that has really been a passion of my heart for some time. Every year at CI, we really believe for the word of the Lord to say what God's saying for the year. And as this is a calendar year 2024 on our calendar, it's actually another year on the Hebrew calendar, which is basically a calendar that started from the days of creation. And so the year for this year is 5784. And so I'm going to talk to you a few things about that. The four for this year in Hebrew is a word, a letter, and a number that actually means a doorway, and that there's going to be some open doorways for you to move through individually in your life and destiny that haven't been opened before. And so we're going to see how some of those are going to happen this year. And then kind of the theme of my message is standing strong in the days of acceleration, right? Standing strong in the days of acceleration. And several years ago, when I was in Canada, the Lord spoke to me and said that we had actually crossed a threshold of time and that we had entered into the days of acceleration. And I knew he was talking about Matthew 24, where it talks about the birth pangs of the last days. And I truly believe that we are in the last days. We're actually in the last minutes and seconds of the last days, and you'll begin to see some of that with some of the things I want to share with you today. But I ministered this message for the first time about a week ago at CI in Florida, and so when I was headed to the service, I was running late, and I was trying to make up time along the way, and I drive about 20 minutes to get there, and we have a long bridge that goes over part of the bay where I travel across, and on the bridge, usually, you can make up a lot of time, all right, because there's usually not many people on the bridge, and the pace of the bridge is usually pretty fast, and so I'm trying to make up time on this bridge. And so there was a car in the kind of the on the passing lane on the bridge that I'm coming up behind, and I tried to help them move over a little bit, all right, into the other lane. And so I come up behind them pretty fast, and later I found out how fast. So this car finally moved over, you know, into the other lane, and I passed it and went up about another half mile or so and went through a stoplight. And then all of a sudden, boom, flashing lights came on behind me, all right? And this was an unmarked police car. And so I pull over and I'm waiting for him to come, you know, and that's when you really cry out to God for mercy and grace and all the things you do, you know. And so he comes over, and I say hello, and he said, well, he said, I clocked you going about 83 on the bridge, which is part of that is like a 45-mile-an-hour speed limit. So 83 and a 45, and he said, coming up like behind me fast, I just said, oh, okay, I'm sorry. And I said, I don't think I've had a ticket, though, in like probably 20 years. And he said, well, I'm not going to give you a ticket, he said, but I am going to check out your registration and do all those kind of things. So So the moral of this story is, when you cry out to God, he does have mercy, he does have grace, all right? He didn't give me a ticket, all right? Although he could have very easily. And so I guess the moral is, follow me as I follow Christ, but not necessarily as I drive, all right? one of the things that I actually did, we do really support our police force. We have one of our elders, actually, that's very involved in hostage and negotiations and things like that in our area. And so we really do support the police. So I have on the back of my truck, I drive a Ford F-150 that's set up and has big tires. And so I have a lot of support your local police stickers on the back of my window, right? So I think that's wisdom. So you may want to get some of those. I'll always have them handy as you move forward. But when I'm talking to him, I said, you know, this is very ironic because the theme of the message that I'm speaking today, it has to do with the days of acceleration, all right? He just kind of laughed and said, well, you can use me any way you want to in your sermon today. So that's what I want to share with you, something about this year in particular and about the days of acceleration that we are headed into. When I was in Canada and the Lord spoke to me about crossing that threshold, since that point of time, it's been about 10 years, actually, that we've seen really an exponential curve of acceleration. And that's really what acceleration means in a scientific term. It's not that you speed up and level off at a speed, but the idea of acceleration, which is change of velocity over time, is that you increase your speed and continue to increase it. And so that's what's happening in the earth today. If you haven't seen some of the things that are going on, we really are in that exponential curve of the end days. I think, you know, even 10 years ago, we wouldn't have thought we'd be talking about some of the things we are today in the earth and in the world. But the good news is that these birth pangs of the last days are not what we should be focused on, but in the very same way that when ladies have babies, you know, the birth pangs have to be endured for a season, but the focal point is never on the birth pangs, it's always on the baby, all right, as a baby comes. And so the baby in this case is Jesus returning to the earth, and it says, you know, the dead in Christ will be raised first, and then we who are alive will be caught up in the air. And so I want to share some things with you about when that's going to happen, and some of the things that we can look forward to. And so I'm going to have you turn with me to Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to read through some of the scriptures there. And it says, and Jesus came out, we'll begin in verse 1, and Jesus came out from the temple and was going away when his disciples came up to point out the temple buildings to him, and he answered and said to them, do you not see all these things? Truly I say to you, not one stone here shall be left upon another which will not be torn down. And as he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, and they asked him three questions here, all right? And we have a slide, maybe we can put up this first slide. shall be preached in the whole world for a witness to all the nations, and then the end shall come. And so when it talks about the things that we're looking for, wars and rumors of wars, famines, earthquakes, all these things that are mentioned in the scripture, that's not yet the end. The end comes after the gospel of the kingdom is preached to the entire earth. All right, and we're in a season now with technology where that can happen very quickly. We're hearing great reports of underground churches in China and Iran that are happening right now. Many coming to know the Lord by visions and by dreams and by very supernatural ways. And so as we are looking at some of the things that are happening right now, for example, the war in Israel that just broke out, you know, in October. Some people question whether it's World War III or not beginning. There's actually a Bible prophetic sign that there will be a third world war yet before Jesus comes. It talks about it as a sixth trumpet war in Revelation. And so whether it has begun or not, the nations that are involved right now in the Middle East are the nations that are prophesied to be involved in this last war. And so so we see a lot of these things really happening and unfolding. And one of the good things is that God wants us to be aware of what's happening in the earth. He doesn't want his people to be taken by surprise. It actually says we should be like the sons of Issachar, who know times and seasons of what's going on. For a long time in the church world, there's been a message that has been preached, and many believe it. And the message is one that says that the church will never have to go through any times of tribulation, and that there's going to be a pre-tribulation rapture, the word is used, that will actually snatch the church out before any of the days of tribulation begin. And it's been a very a prolific message that's been out there. There's been Bibles like the Schofield Bible that have endorsed it. There's a man named Clarence Larkin that really had a lot to do with that happening in terms of that view. But I want to encourage you today that I think there's another view that's more real than that one. And so we're gonna look at that. And you may say, well, why does it matter, you know, which one it is? And their answer to that is, if the pre-tribulation one is true, that means that we will be taken out of here, all right, and never have to endure anything. And I'll be happy with that, all right? I'll be happy with that. But on the other side, if that's not true, and the church is left here during some significant days of tribulation, many are going to wonder what's going on because they will have thought we should be taken out of here. Why are we still going through these days? Why is the tribulation? Why are we experiencing that? And so that's why I think it's really important to bring an awareness to the church today of who we are and that we are to be victorious in these end days. It's not to be a thing of fear, but it's to know what's happening and what's going on. And so in reality, I think we're a very chosen generation to really be that generation that can usher Jesus coming back again. It actually says in the Bible that we can speed up when he comes, that we can hasten the coming of the Lord, and that means that we have to be who God's called us to be. And so one of the things that's very important for each of us this year is to know what your destiny is and be fully engaged with that. All right, and you know, there's all kind of things that come to distract us, and you know, try to occupy our time, and troubles and challenges. But we should always have an underlying view in our heart that we're called by God, we have a purpose and we have a destiny to fulfill, and that the Lord is going to maybe speed up these days where we're fulfilling destiny to step into our role of destiny in some significant ways. I just want to minister to a few people today as I share this. I have a message for my sister here in the white, all right? I hear the Lord say that he's called you to be a dreamer, and he's called you to be one to have vision in dreams. And the Lord's gonna begin to reveal some things to you that has to do with your personal destiny, but also family destiny as well. And you're gonna birth by prayer many into their calling of those that you're related to and those that you're gonna war for to bring them into that season. And I hear from my brother right here, I hear the Lord say that he's looking for some radical people, all right, in this day and in this hour that are going to be willing to go toe-to-toe with forces of darkness and not back down because of fear. And I hear the Lord say that he's going to put a boldness in you to reach out to your generation, to reach out to those that you are with on daily basis, to be influential in their lives, and to know that God is for you, and there's been some tough seasons you've had to walk through, some in some arenas of employment that have been difficult at seasons of time with the positions that you've been in, but I hear the Lord say that as you're faithful in the little, he's going to release much. And so, Father, I just loose that now. Father, this young man, in the name of Jesus, I saw a little girl here, in the little blonde-haired girl, but I don't see her right now. Where's she at? Oh, there she is. Okay. I saw you during worship today. All right. And I heard the Lord say that he's made you very creative. And that you like to draw, paint, and create things. And I hear the Lord say that he's given you that special gift, all right, that you're going to use right from now on as you get older and go through school. But eventually, it's going to be very profitable for you. You're going to actually have some business things that have to do with being creative and creating things. And so the Lord is watching over your life and positioning you for all that he has for you. That's going to be a good thing. And are you the grandma? Okay. How many grandma brought kids today to church? How many grandmas brought children? Stand up if you brought a grandchild today. I want to minister to her, but this is a word for the grandmas that did that today. Let me stand up. And I just hear the Lord saying that you've had to fight a difficult fight, right? In what you have had happen. And as I kind of said, sometimes transition happens by choice and sometimes by need. And for you, it's been by need that you've been elected by God to be one that provides security and comfort. And I just heard the Lord say that he's saying to this grandma in the back as well, that he's saying, well done, all right? Well done, that you are, and you're really releasing the generations to God's plan and releasing them to his purpose. And he says, well done. For my sister in the back, I hear the Lord say that there's a significant role of education that's going to be involved with your grandkids. And how God is going to position them for favor. He's going to position them for blessing, all right? And they're never going to be without. They're never going to have lack because God's going to watch over his word to perform it in your life. Amen? Amen, amen. And so look at your neighbor and say, you need to speed up this year. All right. I heard from my sister right here that God has gifted you in several different ways. He's gifted you in academics, but he's also gifted you in some athletic kinds of things. And that's been a passion of your heart. And you've wondered, can there really be a future in this athletic ability that God's given me? And I hear the Lord say, yes, there can be, all right? And that it can provide scholarships in the days of college years. And so the Lord says, as you just consecrate yourself to him, but also to develop in your sports field, that you're going to be amazed at what God does. And you're going to be a leader in those realms as well with the other girls that you're with. They're going to look to you many times to be the courageous one, all right, in what's happening. And you're going to be able to do that. Amen. Amen. And I want you to stand up if you are that Joshua generation that still has to step into destiny. So if you're 55 and above, I want you to stand up. 55 and above. And sometimes, unfortunately, I'm standing with you, all right? Not by choice, but by destiny, I guess. I always say, how did this 35-year-old get in this 60-something-year-old body, all right? Yeah, I may feel like that, all right. Well, Father, I just speak a blessing over this senior team, Lord, this senior warrior team in this house. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, that they're going to be steadfast, even as things unfold, not only in the earth, but in the city as well. And that they're going to be ones that will be like the anchor so that the ship won't be tossed to and fro in the winds of adversity. And that they're going to have a significant role of support in the vision of this house. And so, Lord, I just loose that favor and blessing, God, the double portion even to come on them today. In the mighty name of Jesus. All right. Amen. Hallelujah. So with regard to Jesus coming, there are several things that are yet to happen prophetically that haven't happened yet. And so that's why Jesus is not coming tonight. All right. And he's not coming this week. He's not even coming this month or this year, right? Because there's things yet to happen on God's prophetic timetable that we haven't seen yet. And I'll just mention what a couple of those are. One of those is that the Bible prophesies that there's going to be a third temple built in Israel, all right, where they will actually start to offer animal sacrifices again. And that hasn't happened yet. They actually have everything ready for that to happen. They need something called the red heifer, a very pure red heifer. They have four of those now that could be used to be the first sacrifice for that temple. They have land where it can happen, and they actually have all the utensils that the priests of that temple would use. And so that's one thing that we will know will happen before Jesus returns. So that's going to be something that will be significant. There will be a third world war. It talks about that, about happening actually around the river, the Euphrates River, which is one like in Iraq, Iran area. And it actually talks about a 200 million man army that's going to be involved in that war. And so there's only a few ways right now that army could come forth. It could be China, it could be India, it could be a conglomerate of Islam nations that could put together that kind of an army. And so that's going to happen. We're going to see that happen. And we're already, you know, hearing of wars and rumors of wars, famines, earthquakes will be those things. Finally, the temple is being built. That ushers us in almost to Daniel's 70th week, it's called, which very well could be about 7 years of destiny fulfillment that would happen. And in the very same time that the church is arising to demonstrate power and to demonstrate who Jesus is in the earth with signs, with wonders and miracles that we haven't seen yet. And so it's actually the most glorious day for the church that we're going to be able to be a part of. But at that very same time, there's going to be another ungodly system that rises up in the earth that will be called the New World Order, all right? And it's already happening. There's many elites that meet the things like the World Economic Forum, the World Health Organization, NATO's leading that way. And actually, even the Pope has aligned with the goal. They have some goals, they say, for 2030 to happen, and he's actually endorsed those. And I came out of a Catholic background, all the normal things of Catholicism, and it very recently, actually over about this last year, the Pope has not endorsed same-sex marriage, but he has endorsed same-sex civil unions, all right, to be something that's okay. Now, when we hear about the false Christ that arise, deception that begins to arise, and all those things, we're seeing it happen right now in our lifetime in some ways that we probably never thought it would happen, all right? And so that's why it's good to be about your destiny calling, all right? And to really begin to seek the Lord. He's going to have some new assignments for you in this season. He's going to have you do some things that you've never done before in this season. I hear from my brother and sister here on the second row here that you're going to be called to be some of those actually bombard the gates of hell, right? And that God's going to put that boldness in you. And you're going to have some strategic prayer efforts with some others that you're going to be a part of, and releasing some of the things that God wants to have done in this city. You're going to be a part of that when it happens. I hear for Leonard and Sharon that the Lord has always graced you with a strong community influence. And I hear the Lord saying that as the end days begin to unravel and unfold, there's going to be a lot of questions that happen from people within the city, all right? And they're going to be looking for places of security. They're going to be looking for places of truth, and they're going to be looking for those that know what's happening. And I hear the Lord say that he's going to grace you with an ability to bring that together in terms of more community influence than you've ever had up to this point of time. And I hear the Lord say that he's seen your hearts that have been there to pour out good for people. And because of that, there's going to be great favor that will be upon you guys. And for Pastor Emilio and Mary, I just hear the Lord say that you are going to be that multi-generational leadership team. All right, and you're going to have the ability to cause the seniors to stay on board with the vision as it even begins to shift into some newer things that haven't been there before. And with that shift is where this multi-generational, multi-ethnic army is going to begin to arise. And it's almost going to be like you're going to be an anomaly for some of the churches in the city that don't have that expression. And they're going to look at you and they're going to say, how did they get all those people to come together in any sort of unity? All right? But God's going to give you that ability to do that. And the Lord says that where there's unity, he commands a blessing. And so there's going to be a command of blessing that will come upon you. And I just hear the Lord say that in terms of worship, there are going to be those portals of the heavenlies open during times of worship. And there will be signs and wonders that will happen without laying hands on anyone, but just in the presence of the Lord, because you have a heart for truth. through worship. The Lord said that he's going to come in on the waves of worship and demonstrate who he is. And so, Father, I just loose it now. Father, to Mary today, in the name of Jesus, Lord, a boldness, Lord, and Father, that empowerment by your hand, and I decree it over her now. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, look your neighbor and say, I'm gonna get ready for this year. Okay, now I also wanna talk to you a little bit about this Hebrew year, the 5784. 80, the number 80 in Hebrew, is the word pay, and it has to do with your mouth, all right? And the number 4 is the letter or number Dalet, and it actually looks like a doorway, all right? A doorway. And so that's why this year, prophetically, is going to be a great year of open doors for us, all right? Now, that means a lot to me because when I got saved, the scripture had to do with open doors, and it was Matthew 7:7, and it said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be open. I was an unbeliever in a drug culture with thousands of dollars of marijuana growing on my farm in the Midwest, all right? When God spoke to me that night, all right, and he spoke that particular scripture to me, and by the power of it, I was born again that night and came into the kingdom. And so open doors are very significant. There's some scriptures that said that many times Jesus will be at the door knocking, like on our heart, the door of our heart, for him to bring revelation, for him to bring intimacy, for us to come into a new relationship with him. And so that'll be part of what's happening this year. But there's going to be some ways we get the doors opened, all right, that God has us for this year. One of the ways are going to be motion-activated doors, all right? How many of you know that when they go into a Walmart or any place, just by the fact that you're there, at a right time and a right place, the door opens for you, all right? Now, it'd be great if all of ours were like that, all right? But some of them will be actually like that. And many times that will mean God will just surprise you with a door that he opens that we were never expecting it to open. One example for me personally, I was in Brazil a few years ago, 2 years ago. All of a sudden, my translator said, you've been invited to their White House to meet the president's wife and to pray for her. Her name was Michelle Bolsonaro, and they were a godly president at that point of time. They don't have a godly president now in Brazil. But we went there, were there for 3.5 hours ministering to her and to Brazil, laying hands on a map she had on the wall. But you know what? That was never on my radar to do that day. But it was just because I was in the right place at the right time and God opened a door. And so some of the doors are going to be like that. And then one of the very significant ways that doors are going to get open this year is going to be voice-activated doors, right? Voice-activated doors, meaning that we have to speak and decree the doorways that God has for us. And some of that will be your prophetic words that you've had. I encourage you to get them out, rehearse them again, and begin to decree and declare what God said, even if it doesn't seem possible in any way. One of the most significant prophetic words I ever got, I had to decree it probably 1,000 times over 2 years before it ever happened, all right? And the things that were good at that time got bad for that season, but I always would come back and say, but God, you said, but God, you said. And so that's going to be a significant way that we have to do that this year. For my sister right here in the kind of animal print, yeah, I hear the Lord say for you that you're going to have the ability to do that this year. And that God's already put some goals and some targets concerning faith and where God wants to take you. And you've known that in your heart and in your mind. But it seemed like a lot of those doors were completely shut. But I hear the Lord say, He's going to anoint your voice to carry weight of authority in the heavenly places. And many times what we have to do is part the demonic realm of delay and resistance to walk out the thing that God had said. And God's going to give you an ability to do that this year and take you into new things and new seasons. Lord, that anointing of the prophetic in her heart that's bold for her, Lord, we loose that and we decree that now in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. All right, and then another way that doors get opened is that we push them open.
It's ready to go.
Is that we push them open, all right? And so some of the things that God has for you, you're going to have to push open this year, all right? They won't happen just by being there. They won't happen necessarily just by your decree, but it's going to take some action to do it. And so that could be fasting, could be prayer, could be walking and anointing your property. One of the things I really believe that's important this year as we're heading into Passover is take time to pray through your homes, to cast out things of darkness, and begin to anoint the doorways to be a place of blessing and favor. And that's very, very important for this year in particular, for what God has for us. A few years ago, I've usually been both in the business world and ministry at the same time. And so a few years ago, all the business things were not working. It's like the contracts were not coming through and monies were being held up. And so I went and actually talked to Apostle Jane, and she said, well, I don't know why, she said, but I think you're supposed to anoint your property, to walk your property and anoint it. And so I said, okay, you know, sometimes it's just good to be obedient, all right, to what you know to do. And so so I was traveling a lot, so the only time I had to do it was at night. And so one night, it was pretty late, like 11 or so at night, I decided it would be the time to do it. And at that point of time, we had 5 acres, so it was a pretty long walk around the property. And I thought, you know, in Florida, of course, we have alligators, we have snakes, we've got a lot of stuff in the bushes, you know. And so I thought, I know what I'll do. We had this, at the time, had Dalmatian dogs. We actually had a litter of 10 at one point of time. But there was this one big male dog named Faithful, right? And so he was like always the one that would charge and do things and be rambunctious and jump over the fence and all those kind of things. So I thought, I know, I'll take Faithful with me, and he'll like drive all the alligators away and snakes as I'm carrying this liter of oil and anointing the property. So we get out and we start heading into the bush part of the property, and Faithful will not go first through anything, all right? And so now I'm out there dragging Faithful through the woods, all right, trying to anoint it with oil, which I finally made it around the whole thing. But you know what? Everything changed. All right, contracts begin to come through, monies begin to flow, and you may say, well, how can that do anything? How can, you know, walk into your property, anointing it with oil, make any difference in things happening? But it actually does in the heavenlies, all right? And it actually drives out forces of darkness and delay. You know, even as Daniel prayed, when the angel came with an answer, they said, we heard you the first time you prayed, but we've been battling the prince of Persia to get here, all right? And actually, the prince of Persia is rising up again in this age and being very influential in terms of darkness. And so anoint your homes and houses. During COVID season, I had a really good friend, a minister, that was really on his deathbed with COVID. And the Lord spoke to me, and it was kind of crazy. It was about around Passover time. And he said, call them up and tell them to eat a meal of lamb like the Israelites did before they left Egypt, all right? And so I did. I called them up, and they said, we never eat lamb, but we had actually just been kind of thinking about that.
And so so they did. They had this meal of lamb, and I really believe it was just a point of contact for their faith. Soon after that, he was he completely set free. I just had dinner with him this month, all right? And God raised him up off of a deathbed and set him free, and they anointed their house during that time saw God do some great things. And so that's really going to be important this year, to consecrate the things unto the Lord that we have stewardship over. One of the things it says about the last days, it said that the days are going to be like the days of Noah. All right? And so God's looking actually for a Noah generation to arise, all right, in this season, to be set apart, not corrupted by the world system. So he's looking for us to be that generation to do that, all right? And so sometimes we just have to, by acts of faith many times, prophetic acts, we push doors open. And then the last way that doors get open. And the Lord just brought this revelation to me just within the last week or so, a couple weeks. How many of you ever seen a SWAT team open a door? All right. You know, they do it a little differently than by voice, by motion, just by pushing. They actually bombard the doorway and break it open. And there's a scripture that tells us that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And so we need to be those that are breaking through the gates of hell to set people free and to see God's kingdom come. And so the great news is your SWAT team are angels, right? Your SWAT team are angels for this year, all right? And that a lot of the things that we need to get victories in, we won't get them by ourselves. And that we're gonna need angels on assignment with us to get the victories that God has purposed in this last day, especially since there's gonna be an intensity of darkness that comes up. There's gonna be intensity of light that's gonna rule and reign. And so God's got some angels for you this year, all right, that we need to activate to open up doors that God has for us to break into and to step through this year. I've had quite a few experiences with angels, and I think I've shared one of them with you about one time angels were very involved in one of the healings that manifested for me. Even though Jesus is a reason for every miracle, angels are on assignment to help us get those miracles. And so that was one of the things that happened. But one of the funny things that happened, and it really illustrates the SWAT team effect, is that I was in California doing a conference. I was actually on miracles, and somehow the home I was staying in, I got my bedroom door locked while I was out of it, and there was no way to get back into the room. It's like there wasn't a key, there wasn't, the hinges couldn't be seen. It was just a difficult thing. And so I was with the host of the conference, and we were working with it, some of you know her name's Candy McAlpine, and so I'm with her, and she said, "I know what we need to do." She said, "We need to ask the Father to send angels." All right. And so she raised her hand up and said, "Father, send the angels." And that door exploded open, all right, without anybody touching it, all right, without any human touch at all. The door exploded open. And you know what? God's got those for us this year. Amen. Some pathways of destiny that are going to be opened by angels co-laboring with you. Now, the Bible says that angels hearken to the voice of the Lord, or they listen for the voice of the Lord. And so that means we have to say what God says. So if you're in a difficult situation and it's like you don't have any idea how you're ever going to get out of that, find a scripture that says what God says, all right, about it. If it has to do with lack or something concerning money, you know, we can make a decree that God meets all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And that activates angels to work with us to see that fulfilled. If it's healing in your body that you need, as you begin to decree, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed, there will be angels on assignment to battle spirits of cancer or diabetes or whatever can be named. And so that's the way angels work, all right? And it's a good thing that in this season of time where we're waiting on Jesus to return, there's going to be an increase in angelic activity. That happens when God does something significant. When Jesus was born, of course, an angel spoke to Mary. There were angels in the field that the shepherds saw. There was like an increase of angelic activity that began to stir. And that's going to happen for us now as we're waiting on Jesus to come back again. And then I want to finish this passage in Matthew to answer this question about when Jesus is going to return. And to shorten it up a little bit, look in verse 21. And it says, "For then there will be a great tribulation, such as not occurred since the beginning of the world until now, nor ever shall. And unless those days had been cut short, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days shall be cut short. Then if anyone says to you, 'Behold, here is the Christ,' or 'There he is,' do not believe them. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and will show great signs and wonders so as to mislead, if possible, even the elect. Behold, I have told you in advance. If therefore they say to you, 'Behold, he's in the wilderness,' do not go forth, or 'Behold, he's in the inner rooms,' do not believe them. For verse 27, for just as a lightning comes from the east and flashes even to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Wherever the corpse is, there the vultures will gather." And then verse 29 tells us when Jesus is coming. "But immediately after the tribulation of those days," and that's referring to this great tribulation, "but immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other." And so that's really the answer of when Jesus is coming back again. All right. It's going to be after the tribulation of those days. And so even though we have to look forward to some, maybe some things that are going to be challenging, we need to always maintain the view in our heart that the church will be triumphant when Jesus comes. All right. It won't be a weak church. It won't be a church hiding in fear, but it will be a church demonstrating who Jesus is and preaching the gospel to the ends of the earth. And you know what? We're there in this season of time to make that happen. I also feel for the house, and especially for you apostles, that there are going to be nations that are going to open up to you, all right? And you're going to take some teams to the nation, all right? And going to be sent strategically on assignment, so your influence won't just be here in the city or state, but God has a couple of nations in particular that you're going to be involved with and in some significant ways. Mexico, I sense, will be one of those, and that there's going to be unique connections that happen for you in that nation, and to see you release the word of the Lord in that day and in that hour. All right. Well, are you ready to have some angels with you this year? All right, I'm just having you stand with me today, and I just want to make a decree over you that you have every SWAT team member that you need this year, all right? In addition to what you do, angels will be there to help you get breakthroughs that you've never had before. And so, Father, I thank you for each one here today, and Lord, I decree over their lives, Lord, that this is a year where you're going to open doors that have been locked up until now. And Lord, I pray that they have great revelation of how to get through those doors by motion, by voice, by pushing, but also, Lord, by the angelic host of SWAT teams with us this year. And Lord, I decree that over their homes and families. God, the things that have warred against them and brought delay until now, Lord, we decree that we'll be the ones that will go through the door and set many captives free. And Lord, I loose that today in the mighty name of Jesus. All right, I'm just going to lift a shout to the Lord this morning. All right. Hallelujah. And I believe we're going to have some great testimonies this year of physical miracles, healing miracles, financial miracles, destiny miracles, that you're on track, all right, for what God has. And so we'll be standing with you at CI. That mantle upon Bishop for the apostolic and prophetic is flowing down to you for this season. Bishop has never said, like, exactly when he thinks Jesus is going to return, but he has many times through prophetic words as he's ministering to people and stuff, like reveal some things that we're all writing down. Like he's writing these down about these dates and things like that. And so for many years, there's been a lot of things that has pointed to the year 2030. All right. And I'm not saying Jesus is coming back at 2030, but I believe that we're going to have a whole new revelation of the end days with the year 2030. And you know what? That's going to come fast, all right, as we see that. All right. God bless you.
Praise God. Praise God. You may be seated. I want to ask the ushers to come down with the offering bags. We're going to receive a love offering for Apostle Gale. And I want to challenge you this morning. You know how sometimes maybe you're in a hurry and you want to get a meal, and so you cruise into a fast food place and you whiff down a Big Mac or a Burger King or whatever, and you know, shell out a few bucks because, hey, you know, it tasted good and you were hungry and you're grateful, and that's great. But then there are those times when you really need a nourishing, well-balanced, and very tasty, expensive meal. And you go to a nicer restaurant because sometimes it's worth the extra investment to get a well-balanced, nutritious, good-tasting, healthy meal. This has been one of those kind of meals. And so don't just put a tip in the offering today, okay? But dig deep. Listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And let's show the Lord our appreciation for what we have heard today. So, Father, we ask you to bless this offering now in Jesus' mighty name. If you're writing a check, make it out to Covenant of Grace, and we'll make sure it all gets to Apostle Gale. While we're taking the offering, let me mention... Oh, you can also Zelle. If you don't have a check with you or if you don't have cash, you can Zelle. Don't ask me how that works, okay? I'm not a techie, all right? What do they do? Zelle, just look up Covenant of Grace or whatever?
Yeah, Zelle to Covenant of Grace.
Zelle to Covenant of Grace.
480-881-381. Okay.
0806.
Say it again.
One more time. Here we go, people. 480-381-0806. If we can somehow put it up on the screen too, that'd be great. 480-381-0806. Thank you very much.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yeah, for Gale. Put for Gale. Go ahead, ushers. I am so encouraged by this message. I'm just ready to shout. The first book I read when I became a Christian was The Late Great Planet Earth by Hal Lindsey. And so I drank the Kool-Aid. I was convinced that Jesus was going to come back, you know, by 1980. That was in 1971. And didn't happen. One of my first Bibles was a Schofield Reference Bible. So I was indoctrinated into dispensationalism. But by the grace of God, the church we were a part of, Gospel Echoes, with Dr. Charles E. McHatton and Pastor Gary Kinneman, neither of them bought into dispensationalism. The systematic theology classes that we took were more balanced and approached it from a more biblical perspective, and I don't have time to get into that. But I've been preaching for years that this whole notion of a pre-tribulational rapture is not biblical, okay? And I've also said exactly what Gale said. If I'm wrong and we go up before the tribulation, you will not hear a word of complaint from me. I wouldn't be unhappy at all to be wrong, but just from what I've read of this scripture, I know that I don't believe that is scripture. It's significant for this reason. How we view the end times determines how we view our destiny. And somebody said it yesterday. I don't know if it was you or Apostle Vance or somebody said, God has not called us to evacuation. He's called us to occupation. Who said that? Was that you? Hector said that. Apostle Hector Torres. That's right. So put this in your spirit. God has not called us to evacuation. He's called us to occupation. Amen. Amen. Okay, are we done with the offering yet? Let's all stand. Do you have books? Okay. Apostle Gale has some books somewhere out there in the community room or the fellowship hall. Go out and look at his books. He's got some great books. So they'll do you good. Father, thank you for our time together today. We ask your blessing upon each and every one as we go our separate ways, Father. We go in your grace. We go having been nourished and enriched by your word. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. We will have some prayer teams available up here. If you need prayer for anything, we'll be happy to minister to whatever needs you may have. God bless you.
Thank you. Let's see, I think that's yours.
Oh, okay.
That's
yours. Six, the last four.
And those are mine. Thank you.